closed strike lockout. Brian, are you there this morning?
Jack, this is the scene outside Trafalgar Junior Secondary School in Nelson this morning. More QP pickets. Despite the announcement yesterday by the Labor Minister that he was going to get QP and the West Kootenay school boards to Victoria on Monday to try and settle this dispute, neither side will budge in the strike lockout situation until there's a final conclusion. So more pickets this morning, more disruptions at West Kootenay schools.
I wonder if anybody has agreed yet to pick up the tab for Fred Pike's fare to Victoria. Might be an answer for that somewhere. So it's the Lalonde, Farris business, it's Vic Stephens, the Conservative leader, and it's Brian Coxgrove, live from the Kootenays.
Yeah, okay.
There are several very disturbing aspects of the announcements in Ottawa yesterday. First of all, it was made quite clear that the Judicial Council has made no investigation into the allegations against Farris. None. All they've done is spoken twice to Chief Commissioner Bob Simmons of the RCMP, who told him that Farris's name might be involved in protected proceedings. No investigation, no witnesses called, no evidence on oath, no clarification of what members of the public are entitled to know. And as far as the other thing is concerned, of course, the politicians would hope that the whole thing will die and go away. And that, of course, is what the legal profession, by and large, hopes. Don't talk about these things. The resignation at the end of the year, they say, is simply enough. We're going to deal with some of the events in the order in which they occurred here, but I think the most important thing for you to see first this morning is the unabridged press conference held by Lalonde yesterday in Ottawa. Oh, first question, I've got to give you a voiceover. He makes the routine remarks, first of all, about wanting to make the report public, and then he comes up to this particular point in the press conference, which goes like this.
I wanted to make it available to the public so that the public should be aware of the facts in this particular instance as soon as possible.
Mr. Lalonde, this report is really a non-report in a way. The Judicial Committee says, well, first of all, we didn't investigate because there might be criminal proceedings, and now we're not investigating because he's going to resign. Is that a wise course? Shouldn't there be some kind of investigation to make sure there isn't anything more to this?
Well, I think you give a pretty short reading to the report of the Judicial Council. The Judicial Council interviewed the commissioner of the RCMP, and they came to the conclusion on the basis of the information they received from the commissioner of the RCMP that there was no evidence of criminal involvement of any kind, and then that the judge had resigned from his function on the basis of the allegations that were mentioned but which were not of a criminal nature, and therefore the council concluded that as far as they were concerned the case was closed.
Mr. Lalonde, do you feel, as Justice Minister, that only criminal activities would warrant the removal of somebody from the bench? You mentioned in your last paragraph of your statement, you note that consorting with a prostitute is not a crime. Are you saying that if that were the only thing involved, then that would be, if not proper behavior, it would allow him to stay on the bench?
Well, the judge has resigned, and I think he has suffered a severe penalty for the allegation that is referred to. I don't frankly know whether the facts are true or not. This is a matter that is not for me to determine. But as far as the statement is concerned, obviously a very high level of conduct, a very high standard of conduct is expected of all judicial appointees. And as far as removing a judge, this is not in the hands of the Minister of Justice itself. It's in the hands of the House of Commons and the Senate, as you know. It has to be done by an address from both houses. And fortunately in our country, if I remember well, we have not had to resort to this particular step. When judges have individual cases in the past, it has been felt that judges had behaved in a way which was not necessarily of a criminal nature, but which was not up to the highest standards, they have resigned on their own. And I would expect that this will be the same in the future. Though quite clearly, a degree of behavior is expected from all judicial appointments, which is above and beyond the simple question of criminality.
In terms of behavior, what's the broader issue? Is the government going to look a little more closely? Are you going to set up new screening mechanisms before you appoint any more Section 96 judges?
No, at the present time, that's not my intention for sure, in the sense that I don't want to engage into a witch hunt every time there is somebody considered for judicial appointments. What happens at the present time is that we are consulting with the Committee of the Canadian Bar Association as to the professional qualifications and the reputation of a particular individual. And obviously, if there is any doubt as to his not only his competence but his qualifications in terms of moral qualities, obviously, then it's a matter that the ministers of justice in the past have investigated further, and that would be my intention in the future as such. But I don't intend to start a special confessional corner where I or somebody else is going to go into the private lives of every Canadian citizen who might be considered for a judicial appointment.
Your statement spells out at length that having sexual relations with a prostitute is not in itself a criminal offense. Are you contemplating a change of the law to make it more even, that the payee would have the same penalty as the other side of the contract?
Well, I'm advised that even asking for money for sexual relations is not in itself a criminal offense either. I refer you to the report of the Law Reform Commission, which was made public yesterday, and which does not recommend any such step at the present time anyway.
Why the December 31st resignation date? Was that simple kindness, or does that enable him to get a pension?
No, he's not entitled to a pension. There were a few judgments still to be rendered, which the judge had heard, and he is on leave of absence in the meantime until December 31st.
What happens in those cases on which judgments are still to be rendered?
Well, those judgments are rendered. The judge is not sitting to hear any case, but there's nothing preventing him from rendering the judgments in the cases that have been heard before the leave of absence has been granted.
Isn't his credibility possibly called into account here? I'm thinking particularly of the Papajohn case, which was a sexual case.
Well, I will not comment on individual cases.
Why does he not get a pension? Would he not have in any case?
He's not entitled because of he's been appointed only, I think, for 5 years. He's not meeting the time requirement.
He's only served 5 years.
Yes.
What is the time requirement that you have to serve?
I believe it's 10 years, but this should be checked in the Judges Act.
One further question, and I don't know whether it really concerns you at all, but Vancouver is rife with rumors that some of the information that the information came out against Chief Justice Farris as a result of some police attempt to get the Chief Justice. It's a two-part question. One, are you aware of these rumors? And two,
yes.
If you are aware of them, does it concern your ministry?
I'm aware of those rumors, and I can say that I have no evidence whatever that there would be any kind of such attempt by the police. I can, as a matter of fact, go further than that and state quite categorically that the information that has been referred to came to the knowledge of the police while they were investigating for something quite different.
They were investigating for drugs. There's no indication, of course, that Mr. Farris was involved in any of that activity, is there?
Well, as a matter of fact, there's not even a charge for drugs against the other people which have been charged since. As you know, the charges have been for keeping a common body house. No charges have been laid for drugs.
But there was a raid.
There was a raid, it appears, yes.
Later you'll hear from Vic Stephens, Conservative leader and a lawyer, the first to speak out for the need for a public inquiry. But in the lobby of the House of Commons yesterday, Tommy Douglas gave an opinion, and his opinion is well worth hearing.
Whether there should be a public inquiry or a judicial inquiry would depend on knowing all the facts. But certainly there ought to be an inquiry, because we don't know whether there are some ramifications of possibilities for blackmail, or whether any other groups were involved, or the underworld.
Douglas, as usual, puts his finger on a number of unexplained and disturbing. It's not the one who's making drawing long bows. One is disturbed when the top judge in British Columbia, when this happens to him. So let's look now at the kind of sequence of events, and we'll roll that these words on the film so we can follow it a little more clearly. It was August the 16th, way back in August, when Farris was caught one way or another with an alleged prostitute. That's quite clear. But it was another 2 weeks before Lang was advised by the RCMP, right? And then it was some considerable time before the next thing actually happened. Let's see it there. What was that? That was when Farris met with Justice Minister Lang in a secret meeting. And Lang said, I think you should resign, or if you don't, you'll have to face a judicial council. And Farris at that time asked for time to consider his choices, either to resign or face the judicial council. And then, because he got no reply from Farris on October the 11th, Lang ordered the judicial council to make a reference to the whole thing. November the 2nd, that was when Simmons went to the judicial council. Once, twice, no criminal implication of Farris. But Farris's name could come out in what might well be a protracted prosecution. And then on November the 8th, Farris indicated his resignation. The judicial council got on the 9th. Now that was the 9th of November. This goes way back to August, 9th of November. And then we've had all this time involved until yesterday. And it turns out that on the 28th, the judicial council have finally made up its mind that under the terms of the Judicial Council Act, once the government had accepted and indicated it was going to accept the resignation, they were freed of the matter and they dropped it. I won't say they dropped it like a hot potato. I'll say they dropped it because that was their particular terms of reference. But it becomes perfectly clear that there was no investigation. Now let's see to the Judicial Council report itself and what the Chief Justice of Canada, Bora Laskin, said in summary about the whole sordid business. Chief Justice Farris considered it was in the interests of the judiciary that he resign rather than risk a protracted association of the name of the Chief Justice of BC with a likely prosecution. Now, we gave you much of the report yesterday, but I want now to go to one of the statements in the considered release by the new Justice Minister, the Honourable Marc Lalonde. And this is very interesting indeed. It is appropriate to say that having sexual relations with a prostitute is not in itself a criminal offence. Farris has voluntarily submitted to the, how does it come after that, roll the tape, voluntarily submitted to the highest penalty available in the circumstances, and that is resignation. The Canadian Judicial Council considers this matter closed. Now that's the nub of what happened yesterday. Judicial Council says we're not involved anymore. Our friend, the new Minister of Justice, was kind of careful in what he said. And as we pointed out last night, there is considerable concern in certain quarters, I'm sure we'll find, that twice in this short period, we have been told, first by the BC Judicial Council, no comment, and then by the Judicial Council of Canada, that for a judge to have sexual relations with a prostitute is not in itself an offence. We don't need elementary law lectures from anybody on this particular subject, because we in Vancouver have studied and know well the pests and the rogues and the vagabond who infest the streets. And we don't have to be told that, but what we have to be told, that for a judge to have relations, sexual relations, with an alleged prostitute, or a prostitute in fact, as happened in the Benrod case, must be some kind of severe offense if there's going to be any moral standard set for the community whatsoever. I shall be interviewing Vic Stephens, leader of the Conservative Party, on this particular point. But first, after this break, we're going to go back up to the West Kootenays and live coverage of the school dispute and the developments which, since McGeer was on this program last week, to our reporter Brian Coxford.
Probably start with a bit of a turkey that what is this supposed to be? Yeah,
off there here.
Okay.
Brian. Brian, what's new in Nelson this morning? Who's your guest and what are you going to tell us?
Jack, we've got two guests with us. The first one is Tara Melnechuk, a grade 12 student who's also president of the student council of the only high school in Nelson. And the dispute started right at her front door at the L.V. Rogers School back on October 26th. But as for anything that's new, it's pretty well the same ball game that's been played for the last couple of days. More picketers out today. QP picketing Trafalgar Junior Secondary School. As we told you yesterday, despite the developments from the Labor Minister, it's still a situation of strike lockout. Neither side's going to lift it. They'll go to talks on Monday.
In Victoria.
But as far as any kind of change in this situation here, it's going to have to produce a settlement before we see any development here.
Just one question before you turn to your interview. Has Fred Pike managed to raise the fare yet? I thought the QP was loaded with union funds.
Well, he doesn't really have any intention of raising the funds. He wants it to come from Victoria. He thinks the Labor Department should spring the bill, or perhaps Alan Williams and whoever he needs to get involved in this situation should come to the West Kootenays.
But might he not go if somebody doesn't send him a ticket?
That's what he says.
Still says that today?
Yep.
Oh, you gotta be joking.
See, we're looking at about a dozen people on each, if we take the two sides, the school board and QP, we're looking at about a dozen people to catch flights out of here to Victoria. And they would have to catch flights out of Castlegar Airport. And it's been socked in for the last couple of days. So, you know, if the weather holds the way it is, the chances of getting out on a weekend aren't that good anyway.
Okay, what does your student have to tell us?
Okay, it's Tara Melnechuk, as we said, the president of L.V. Rogers Student Council, that's the high school in Nelson. And Tara, as far as the class situation, as far as you're concerned, has it really put a crimp in your studies so far, the dispute?
Well, the teachers are doing the best they can to give us our full education, but classes have been cut by about at least an hour a day. And that means that all the enrichment stuff, anything extra that can possibly be cut, has been cut from our schoolwork. It's a pain going 4 hours a day. We're not used to that much pressure, four straight hours of classes. So all in all, I'd say yes, our schoolwork is definitely suffering.
So the good students can probably get by, but the average and below average students are the ones that are really going to suffer in this.
Yes, I think so. All students, good or not, are having problems with their homework. We're not motivated at all to even try and work. It's just go and that's it.
Terry, how about trying to get into the school? Have you been stopped by mass pickets at your particular school, or have you and your teachers always managed to get there?
No, so far we haven't been mass picketed, but we're expecting it any day, and I don't think we're going to be able to get past the picket lines.
But tell me, how do you feel about it? I mean, really, your gut feeling. Are you really, who are you angry at? Are you angry at Cupid, or are you angry at the strikers, or who are you mad at?
I'm mad at both of them. I'm just frustrated. I want my education, and I'm not getting it. I don't really care who's right or wrong. As far as I'm concerned, they're both at fault, so I'm mad at both the board and Cupid.
So you've been out since the 26th of October, right?
That's right.
Do a number of the kids just kind of take it easy and say, oh, well, who cares?
That, you got it, that's it exactly.
That's probably the biggest danger of all.
Yes, I'd have to agree with you there.
What about the younger ones? How about the younger ones? How are they taking it?
They're having real problems because they need their teacher's motivation. I assume you're talking about the elementary
yes,
school?
Yes.
Okay, the elementary schools, parents have been complaining that children come home to do the homework and just throw it on the floor because they're not motivated at all anymore.
It seems a real shame. Well, right as of this moment, the only thing that's going to happen, apparently, is the meeting on Monday if CUPE can raise the fares. And who knows, it might be the end of January before anything happens at all.
Yes, that's what I'm expecting. I don't really think anything is going to come out of these Victoria talks at all.
Has there been any vandalism around the schools? Or?
Oh, yeah. As far as I know, Trafalgar's okay, but LVR, the students are so frustrated that they're rebelling in any way they can. Our school vans have been the windows busted, about $1,500 worth of damage to school windows, you know, bathrooms, pipes broken, things like that.
That's a real shame.
Yeah.
So nothing in sight at all, and who knows what's going to happen. How do your parents feel about it? Are they mad about it?
Oh, yeah. They're upset. They're complaining about, you know, our education suffering, especially in grade 12, my last year, the most important year.
Are you planning to go on to university or what?
Yes, I am, and I'm getting pretty worried about it.
Are you going to go to Selkirk College or are you coming down here?
I haven't decided yet. I think I'll go to Selkirk for a couple of years and then come down to Vancouver.
Well, you've no worry about yourself, and that you know that you can get enough into your head to be ready for university regardless.
Well, we've been guaranteed that we'll graduate, but...
What does that mean, though, guaranteed?
That means that no matter how long the strike's lasting, I don't have to go back for another year of school.
In other words, they'll give you their technical graduation.
Yes, that's about it. I'll know the basic requirements, the core curriculum, but... For university, I'd rather have the extras.
I don't blame you at all. Terry, thank you very much. You're an excellent spokesman for the students. Brian, I'll be back to you after this break.
Thanks, Jack.
Gwyneth De Vries.
Now, I can... Michelle, Linda, can somebody tell him to phone you at 10:30 for sure, because he's got an ENG job Sunday afternoon.
Can you stick up the vest there? Just underneath the vest.
Morning. Where's Suzanne?
Student council, what kind of staggered basis have you been put on, like, is it a...
Well, we have all our classes and all our options, but it's six classes a day in 4 hours is kind of hard because they're only 33-minute classes.
Mm-hmm.
So students, it takes a while in junior high to settle down, like, especially the grade 8s, they want to play for about 10 minutes before they get into their classes, and then teachers have about 20 minutes to teach. It's hard to teach.
Brian, just before you do your interview, how common is the feeling up there that had these 14,000 children been forced out on the streets or partial education in cold classrooms, had it been down in Victoria or Vancouver, how strong is the feeling that it would have been settled long ago?
Oh, I think the feeling is quite strong, particularly among the students, that the West Kootenays is a long way from Victoria and the streets of Vancouver, and they've been somewhat ignored until such time as... It really hit the forefront in terms of the media in the last couple of days.
That's with McGeer and his Essential Services Act.
That's right.
I think he's taken a lot of heat in that that he didn't quite deserve. At least we got him stirred up to get Williams stirred up, to get Bennett stirred up, to get the whole pot stirred up. Would you introduce your guest and interviewer, please, Brian?
Yes, we have Gwyneth De Vries, who's president of the student council at Trafalgar Junior Secondary. And you're in grade 10. And I'd like to ask you a bit about what this situation in terms of the you know, the staggered class situation has done to school spirit. You're president of the student council. Any kind of activities or anything that are going on?
Well, we don't have any activities going on right now. We tried to run some things, but the students just won't turn out. They won't come out to the things that we're trying to have.
Mm-hmm. What's your feeling in terms of the government being sort of dragging their feet and suddenly they're getting involved? Do you think it's they've been less than responsible in this particular situation?
Well, in terms of what students think, I think they're just really impatient, like, to get the government in there to do something, but now that we know that it's not going to be over till maybe January, we don't know what to do.
But Gwyneth, haven't you got good skiing weather up there just now? Are not most of the kids saying, thank goodness, we're on holiday?
Jack is asking you if you've got good skiing weather up here and perhaps it's a good time to be on a holiday.
Yeah, we've got a lot of snow right now, and well, we've been out of school for 2 days now because of the pickets, and I guess if ski hills open on Monday and so is the school, the kids are going to choose the ski hill.
That's a shame, isn't it? What about the classrooms, or when you've been out of school for 2 days in a row now because of the pickets, is that right? I'll ask the question again. The Coopy pickets have stopped you and the teachers from going into the school for the past 2 days, right? Eh?
I can't hear him.
Can't hear me. Brian, can you hear me?
We'll try that one more time, Jack.
I was just saying that for the past couple of days, they've been blocked out by the Coopy pickets, right?
For the past couple of days, you've been at Trafalgar, you've been blocked off by the Coopy pickets. That's the situation, isn't it?
Uh-huh. And the kids come to school, but they find out that they're not allowed in, so they just turn away. There's no groups of friends that walk away. Everyone just goes home alone. And there's no really socializing that there was before the strike.
What about this guarantee that you're going to get your year anyway? That certainly would put a complacent attitude in the minds of the students, wouldn't it?
Yeah, well, they know that they'll pass, but they don't know what they're learning. They think that they're learning things, but not what they'd learn if
Brian,
there wasn't a strike.
Ask Gwyneth what the teachers appeared to think about the situation. They must be saying something in class.
The teachers, are they saying anything in class, picking any sides, or...?
No, the teachers, they're explaining the situation if the kids want to listen. So the students are, well, neutral, and they're just waiting for something to be done, and they're starting to get impatient.
Have any kids dropped out to pick up part-time jobs or anything?
Any students at all maybe given up for the year, picked up part-time jobs or anything like that?
No, everyone's still going. They're fairly calm, but they just want to get back to school normally.
Can she tell us about any vandalism in her school?
Any vandalism at your school?
No, there's no vandalism. Everyone's quite calm. I think they're maybe still stunned that there is a strike, and they're just trying to cooperate so that we don't get in trouble.
When do you think it's going to be settled?
Well, personally, I think that it won't be over until January, that they're not going to do anything over Christmas.
Mm-hmm. She may well, Gwyneth may well be a very perceptive observer in that, because you know how difficult it is to move Alan Williams, and the only hope now is a massive petition of protest to the Premier and to McGeer, as well as to Williams, and maybe they'll realise this is more than just something far off in the West Kootenays, but something that can happen in many other parts of the province. Brian, what are you doing next?
We're going to just check out the situation as it is here today, Jack, and see if there's any more developments. But the way it looks right at the moment, the next card, I think, in this game is probably going to have to be played in Victoria on Monday. And where they go from there is anybody's guess. But in terms of the strike lockout situation and more disruptions and more vandalism, etc., it's going to continue until they get a contract between the two parties.
Okay, Brian, thanks very much to you and Grant and Ken, your videotape crew, and to the BC Telephone Company crew who set up the facilities for us. And by the way, would you phone Linda? An ENG job for you Sunday afternoon.
Okay, we're saying goodbye from Nelson.
Thank you very much, Brian Coxford. Break. Take it away.
Trying to cut down on the smoke.
That'll work.
To be perfectly fair and accurate on the Farris affair, I'll repeat just once again that from the reports yesterday that there is no evidence suggesting criminal involvement of John Farris. There were some other things said which I regard as kind of disturbing in relation to the bench at large. But first of all, Vic Stephens, the leader of the Conservative Party in British Columbia, himself a lawyer, practiced and experienced lawyer, was the first politician to speak out publicly. And Mr. Stephens, you may well be aware of the fact that I have found it virtually impossible, except for Stu Leggett, who came on yesterday, and yourself, let me think of anybody else, to have a leading member of the profession who is prepared to talk about the Farris case at all. Is that something which, before we talk about the implications of all this, which disturbs you? And if so, why would it disturb you?
Well, the Farris case?
No, the fact that the legal profession seems to have a similarity of interests which prevents it from speaking out on the case.
All right, well, there's two things. First of all, Jack, the legal profession is terrified to speak out in any event. They're afraid of their own association. As you know from the experiences that you and I have had in the past on this, that when a lawyer speaks out, he's afraid he's going to get into difficulty. That's too bad, but that's a fact of life. The second thing is, of course, that there's one thing about the establishment, particularly the legal establishment. When it gets into trouble, it does regroup and protect itself. I think that's a natural tendency of any establishment, and we're seeing it with the lawyers right now.
You mean it closes like an oyster shell?
Of course it does.
Or a clam shell?
Of course it does. And that's partly the problem behind this. That's partly the reason for the wrong decision of the judicial counsel in the Benrod case. We need fewer lawyers on that counsel, and I think we'd get better judgments.
Are we going to talk about both cases this morning?
Well, I don't think you can. I don't think that you can talk about one without the other. They have similarities, but quite frankly, in my opinion, the Farris case is much more serious than the Benrod case. Judge Benrod at least had the courage to admit his indiscretions and go before the public and stand up and be counted. I'm concerned.
Well, I want to correct you on that right now. I'm not admitting that he admitted it. I'm not denying that he admitted his discretions. But the entire game plan of the Judicial Council of British Columbia, and I say this without fear of contradiction, was to hold a secret hearing without the public knowing even where it was in the Benrod affair. And they were pushed into a public hearing, partly by myself and partly because somebody in the Attorney General's office finally realized that it's done openly in other parts of the country and it must be done here. But surely the Benrod affair in its own way is as disturbing as the Farris affair.
Well, they're both disturbing, of course, and the decision of the Judicial Council in the Benrod case was wrong, quite clearly wrong. But we have had a public hearing. The public is made aware. The Farris case is very, very bad because when Farris left the bench, he left a cloud, not only on the judicial system, but on all of the other members of the judiciary. The possibility is that he's been forced to resign on false allegations. That was the indication he gave us. That there may have been no substance to the allegations against him.
Well, now let's look at that. You're a lawyer. You're better with fancy words than I am. If a senior judge is forced to resign by false allegations, is there a short word for that? No, I'm being unfair to you.
There no doubt is a short word.
Yeah, but no, the short word that I'm thinking of. And Tommy Douglas mentioned it this morning. It means that could we have another judge totally clean, totally innocent of all wrongdoing.
Of course, that's the point.
Because he faced it's blackmail. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, that's the point. The point is that if Farris did not do anything wrong, he should stand up and fight. If he has done something wrong,
or
has been indiscretion, he should admit it. And if he won't admit it, then we should have a full public hearing as we did in the Benrod case.
Let me get that again. Now, I think you made a very cogent point there. If Farris has done something wrong which caused him to flee from his job,
he should admit it.
He should admit it.
Absolutely.
And if he does not admit it, there should be a public inquiry.
Absolutely. No question about it.
Well, I haven't softened my position, but had the Judicial Council conducted a full inquiry, and had they outlined, in fact, after taking evidence, the full circumstances, that might have been sufficient.
Well, perhaps it was, but I still think the public is entitled to know. The public is entitled to participate, and this goes right to the heart of our freedoms and our justice system, and the public has to participate in these judgments. They should not be made by politicians behind closed doors.
In other words, if we don't trust our judges, the society is dead.
Well, of course, and listen, our whole justice system is based upon the concept of a public hearing. The public is entitled to know, except in very exceptional circumstances, what is going on in our courtrooms. Nobody can be tried in our courtrooms without the public knowing about it. And this is the same thing.
Let's try this on for size. This is a quote from Lalonde's statement yesterday. And I made maybe a snide remark about it but last night. We'll see how you react, Vic. Vic Stephens, of course. Quote from Lalonde. I have been advised by senior police authorities in BC that they have no evidence that other federal judges are involved with prostitutes. And he goes on to support the request of the Attorney General of BC, who has not shone in this matter, that if someone has any information to the contrary, they should immediately contact the proper authorities. Now, what do you think of that statement and its capability of giving the public confidence in the superior courts?
Totally misses the point. Totally misses the point. That's not the point at all. I don't care what the police are telling the Minister of Justice. What I want to know is the truth. The public wants to know what happened. The public wants to know whether the number one judge in the province of British Columbia has been forced to resign from the bench on a false allegation. And if he has, Jack, that's a very, very serious thing.
But go on, that's good.
The other judges who sit on the bench are entitled to know. They're entitled to know whether they're going to be faced with the possibility of having to resign on a false allegation.
Surely the other judges are entitled to be cleared less speciously than that statement.
Of course they are.
I mean, as I said last night, if I were a senior judge in British Columbia, county court judge or a Supreme Court judge, I would be demanding now of the Canadian Judicial Council that I not be left with the slightest slur attached to my name. If anybody knows anything wrong about me, would you please call the authorities?
Well, I don't think it's necessary for us to go into a witch hunt or an examination of every judge on the bench.
I'm not concerned about that.
What I'm concerned about is the Farris case. Let's have a public inquiry on the Farris case. That in itself is essential.
But what I'm suggesting to you too, and this might surprise you, is that I believe that as far as the quality and caliber of the judges in the Supreme and County Court in British Columbia, they are at the highest level they have ever been in my years in the province.
Yes, and don't forget the provincial courts. It's been my experience that the best justice in this land is handed down in the provincial courts, formerly called the magistrates' courts, formerly called the police courts. That's where the best justice is, and don't forget it.
Here we come to a slight crossing. Sure, there is excellent justice from a large number of judges on the provincial bench, but there are other judges with problems with which the Attorney General is well aware, about which nothing will be done, because don't forget that in the Benrod case, nothing would have happened at all. He would have remained on the bench as an acute alcoholic with a year to live if that fellow, what's his name, Peden, hadn't belled the cat.
Yes, I'm sure
that's
the
biggest weakness of the administration of law and justice in BC on the provincial level.
That's a delicate thing, though, Jack.
What
are we going to do? How far are we going to go with this? Are we going to constantly examine the conduct of every man on the bench?
Only when it becomes apparent.
Well, that's right. But you probably have more information than anybody in British Columbia as to the conduct of some of the judges on the bench. What do you do about it?
I lobby back doors with the appropriate officials, hoping they will take the proper action.
Well, that's
right. But they don't take it. So we've got to I didn't rely. Nothing to do with Peden. But it was Peden who belled the cat. And where I've lost confidence, of course, is in the BC Judicial Council, except for one member, Jake Brower, a layman.
Yeah, one member did the right thing.
How many lawyers sat in that? Two,
I think there's three or four.
Yeah, it's two. Full three or four.
There's too many. There's just too many. That's all there's to it. One would be enough. One may be too many.
Do you think we're making too much of a fuss about the whole thing?
No, I don't think we are at all.
I think the man in the pub says, there's Stephens looking for political advantage. There's that loudmouth rabble-rouser Webster, you know, who probably has skeletons in his own closet, jumping on poor John Farris.
Well, that's the job that we both do. That is our job.
I would suggest to you that if we don't fight this to get the full and final answers, that we'd be knuckling under to the worst wishes of those in the establishment who want to bury it.
Yeah, I'd like to know where the other members of Parliament stand, too. I'd like to know where the British Columbia members of Parliament stand. I haven't heard too much from them.
Oh, you should have seen the procession of MPs we had on, from Mark Rains to Art Lee and through all the rest of them, saying, he's resigned, it's over, it's over. Yeah. When I've spoken to some of the people in Ottawa, they've known nothing about the circumstances. Yeah. Nothing at all. More with Vic Stephens, and we're going to take your telephone calls very shortly, too. We might even talk some politics later.
Well, if we have to, if we really get stuck for something to do, we'll get into politics.
When have we ever been stuck? Yeah. Webster and Vic Stephens. You know, let's be philosophical for a moment, if we dare. You were saying that probably the public mood is turning against people with views like yours and mine.
No, what I said was that I think that Benrod has had his share of publicity, and I think it's wrong. I don't think it was ever your intention or anybody else's intention to give him more misery than he already has. You know, but the public's had its hearing on that one, rightly or wrongly. It's had its hearing. I think that one is going to settle down, but the other one we've got to stay on.
Let's just have a look at this. And I don't know how you tell this to the public or what the devil you say about it. Having sex with a prostitute is not in itself a criminal offense. You are, of course, were aware of that as a lawyer, Mr. Stephens, right?
Yes.
I am aware of as a reporter, Mr. Stephens. Having sex with a prostitute only becomes a criminal offense for the prostitute in the main, although it can be for the customer, if they conduct a body house or pressingly solicit on the streets, Deborah Hutt case, or live off the avails of prostitution. The sale of sex between man and woman or whatever, especially whatever in this town, is not in itself a criminal offense.
No.
Should it be a criminal offense for judges? In other words, it's quite obvious that the code of ethics, which they each has, both provincially and federally, the code of ethics doesn't seem to work in some cases, does it?
Well, judges
should it be a should that be a dismissal offense for a judge?
I don't think we should start codifying a special list of offenses for judges.
Oh, no, you're right.
They're people, like everybody else.
We'd have to say judges will not rob banks. Judges will not do this.
Oh, yeah, no, you can't do that.
You can't do that.
No.
But if a judge is caught with a hooker, that should surely be ipso facto curtains.
Well, I think that Farris did the right thing. No, I think Farris did the right thing in resigning. My concern is that he left behind him some doubt as to whether he should have resigned or not. Nobody has to be a judge, Jack. If you choose to put yourself in that position, then you should, I think, appreciate that you'd probably deny yourself some of the luxuries of life that are open perhaps to other people.
You limit your social activities.
Yes, you do.
You restrict your association.
Yes, you do.
You must not mix with criminals.
That's correct.
You must not be seen drunk in public. You can only get drunk in private if you so wish.
Yes, I think
or have one over the eight in private if you so wish, right?
Exactly.
Well, I think...
The public expects more from the judges, from our judges, than it expects from other people, and that's quite rightly so.
And, of course, there is the possibility of blackmail. You notice Lalonde on the clip this morning admitted that, yes, there had been a drug raid, right? I interviewed the girl involved, and, yes, her door was broken down by eight Mounties whom she thought were thugs on a writ of assistance, which was at the time they seized certain documents. On the basis of that, and on the basis of Lalonde's statement that it was only a body house charge and that drugs were not found, there was no drug charge, does that in itself, in addition, warrant a public inquiry as to all the circumstances?
Jack, I can't say any more than I have. The fact of the matter is that the public inquiry is essential to clear the air because we're entitled to know what the situation is. And you can't make excuses for it. Anything Lalonde says or anybody else says are simply attempts to sweep it aside, push it under the rug. I don't think we should permit that to happen. And
I can't think of anything of such a serious nature happening all my time in BC. Can you?
No.
Well, you were born and bred here.
No, I've been here most of my life, but I'm an Albertan born.
How long have you been practicing as a lawyer?
Well, I'm not practicing now, Jack.
But how long
for the first time
yet?
In 23 years. I've been practicing for 23 years.
I'll tell you what we'll do now. We may talk a bit of politics, but perhaps we should take one segment of phone calls on the Farris affair to see how people react to your position.
All right.
And your position is that despite the Judicial Council closing the case on it yesterday, through Lalonde, that you still think it should be a public inquiry.
Absolutely. No question about that.
Not a witch hunt.
Not a witch hunt. Not a witch hunt.
You'd have to get a judge. Who would conduct the inquiry?
Well, the Judicial Council, presumably.
Oh, yes. You'd get somebody from the Judicial Council. Borelaskin or Kalatin or one of these people.
One step further. Tommy Douglas indicated he wasn't sure whether it should be a public or a private inquiry. I say it must be a public inquiry. This matter now will never be handled satisfactorily until the public knows or hears the...
Oh, supposing a man of the stature of Laskin held an inquiry and released a report. You would accept that, wouldn't you?
Well, I may not accept it, but at least the public would have some information. The public, of course, would have some information.
But I think you're basically right, that short of a public inquiry, doubts will forever be left.
Yes.
In the minds of thinking people in British Columbia, Because they don't know about it in the rest of the country.
You're dealing with a man who has been quite influential in this province. His whole family has. Quite influential, I'm sure, in the appointment of many of our judges. You're dealing with the heart of the establishment in this case. I see no reason why that should be treated any differently than the way that Judge Benrod was treated.
Good point. Telephone calls to Vic Stephens and Webster. Thank you. Go ahead to Vic Stephens.
Staff and Mr. Stephens, I want you to forgive me for quoting this Shakespeare. I just couldn't resist it. In Hamlet, I wanted to refer you to the gravedigger who was digging up the grave and throwing the skulls about. And Hamlet says, "Geez, that might be the skull of a lawyer." And he says in a cynical manner, "Why does he suffer this rude knave to knock him about the sconce with a dirty shovel and will not tell him of his action of battery?" Now, we have Farris here being accused with no action of battery.
Makes sense to you?
No.
Accused with no action of battery. Farris has certainly been battered about in public. May not have been knocked on the skull, but he's been battered about in public, ma'am.
It's the facts that need to be battered about in public, not Farris.
Go ahead, please, from Quinnell.
Hello. Now, I have been disturbed. What I want to do, first of all, is to congratulate both you and Mr. Stephens in being so outspoken in this delicate matter. I think it's a great public service that you're both doing in connection with it.
Well, Jack started it.
What I was saying was that I think it is fair to say that the public expects from the bench the very highest order of behavior, ethical conduct, as well as all the other things that all the other attributes that are expected from such people when they are chosen for such a high office. I think it is the very highest calling, and I think it goes beyond even Parliament. This is the very fabric of our existence, and I think we ought to be sure that we are getting the very best of service. And although I pass no observations as to the questions involved in this, it is, as you have rightly pointed out, that had it not been for the fact that someone belled a cat, we may never have known this sort of thing. And I think it's rather fatuous of some people in high places to say that there is no criminal evidence, because I think it goes far beyond the question of criminal evidence. I think these people know perfectly well that they are expected to show this high order of behavior and conduct, so that there can be no question from anyone as to their integrity. And if it should arise, then I think it would be better if they were in a position to stand up and say, "Yes, I'm prepared to have any investigation made." When one considers this morning that we hear that a person is before the courts for
income tax return.
Returns, and is going to be pilloried for what would appear to be some trivial matter on there, and is open to a fine of $500 or 3 months imprisonment, and then we think that other people are able to skip over these things by simply saying, "Well, according to what we know in our investigations, there would not appear to be any criminal activity." I think it goes far beyond that, and I think we are entitled, through our politicians and the members of the Judicial Council, to have a proper and open inquiry into these things, and I thank you very much indeed.
Well said, sir. Well said, sir. You know, go back to the other cases. What would you think if you were appearing, or if you appeared in front of certain judges right now in an impaired driving charge? You'd say to yourself, "I wonder if I can ask that magistrate if he's an alcoholic before he sentences me." Mind you, if I knew he was an alcoholic, I might think, "No, I won't mention it. He might be more sympathetic to me. He knows the problem." We can't have that kind of thing.
No, of course. And as a matter of fact, the judges have always been protected against these kinds of accusations.
Right.
And quite rightly so. The lawyers are reluctant to challenge a judge on that basis at all. It's just simply not done.
Yeah, not done, although they might know or suspect that judge is a trifle impaired as he sits on the bench.
We have learned to presume that all our judges are of the highest caliber, and that is a comfort if we can presume that.
But right at the moment, we cannot.
No, we can't presume that.
Similarly, if you're up on a models charge, what can you presume? I mean, The man there must be a man of perfect public rectitude, not involved with anyone on the periphery of illegality.
Well, that's quite true. However, I don't think we can ever expect perfection from our judges. As a matter of fact, in the day-to-day activities of living, Jack, some of our better judges probably have come from people who have been around a little more than the others.
Well, it was Tom Hurley that used to say that you couldn't be a proper judge unless you'd at least been drunk in the gutter once and spent the night in jail.
A lot of truth in that.
Some truth in it, yeah. And I pushed that a wee bit too prissily, I must say. Next call, Linda. Go ahead, please.
Jack, two questions.
Yes.
If I was in court on a motor vehicle charge, which is not criminal.
Yes, it could be.
Involving my driver's license.
Oh, yeah.
If I handed my driver's license in and went to court, could I beg off because I resigned the position of having a driver's license?
A very good parallel, sir. The man, you get what he's saying? He's faced with an offense involving his particular position as a driver of a vehicle. So he goes and says, I resign.
Well, it's not quite the same. There's some logic there.
It's close.
Yeah, because we're not talking about a judge that's been charged with an illegal act.
Motor vehicle isn't an illegal act.
Oh, yes, it is. Any offense under any statute is an illegal act for which you are entitled to a trial. But we're not talking about that situation. It's close. I understand what you're saying, and the reasoning has some merit, but in the Farris case, what we want to find out is the whole story behind it, whether or not he has resigned wrongly, whether he's been pressured to resign, or whether there's been any influence on him, Jack.
His actions, as Clark Davies said, seemed, though it comes out differently, as I said, seemed tantamount to some form of guilty plea.
Yeah.
Right?
Not only that, Jack, there's a certain amount of pressure, I think, that mounts on people if you think that you can run the risks and then simply walk away from it by resignation, you don't get away with it entirely. But the more difficult it is, the more the public involves itself in these matters, the less likely we are to have a reoccurrence of it.
Thank you. Hold on, please. Go ahead, please.
Hi. I would like to know what happens to the people that alcoholic judge sent to jail and they find out this has been happening. Can they bring that case back into court and get another judge for the trial?
No, that's not likely unless they were able to show that at the time of the conviction he was impaired and unable to render a proper judgment.
It's a logical thought for the man in the street, Mr. Stephens.
Well, it's entirely logical, and that's what was wrong with the Judicial Council's decision. You see, they had evidence before them that if this man continued to drink, he'd be dead within a year, and yet the Judicial Council has the nerve to tell us that there was no evidence that his alcohol interfered with his job or his judging. Now, you know, just plain common sense would tell you that can't possibly be the case.
And that same Judicial Council, the majority of them, knew full well that under their apparently sloppily written act, once again sloppily written, that they had no power to do anything but either recommend firing or do nothing. And faced with the option of recommending firing or doing nothing, they should obviously have fired Benrod.
Can that person in jail come back and ask for another trial?
Oh, he could, but he's not likely to be successful.
Why wouldn't he be successful?
So
this, it said in that admission of fact, which was fairly reasonably carefully structured admission of fact, which left unanswered many questions that you would have asked had you been there as a citizen. I'm not talking about the legal procedures. Many questions. Why shouldn't he?
Supposing, I'm not saying he shouldn't, Jack. Why
shouldn't?
The lady's question was whether or not
you could get a new trial.
Yeah.
Why not?
Well, all I'd say is that if you could show the appeal court that, in fact, at the time the judgment was rendered, the judge was incapacitated, yes, you would get a new trial. I'm sure of it. But how are you going to show that?
Oh, I could show it from the evidence, from the admission of fact in front of the BC Judicial Council by saying
you can't
he
say
was
that.
In such a state that his doctor testified on October the whenever it was that he had a year to live if he continued to drink.
Yeah, but you can't presume from that on the particular case in question that is under appeal that the judge was intoxicated in handling that case. You can't make that.
Oh, common sense would tell you that he must have been affected by the influence of the alcohol.
Well, that common sense tells me that, but how can you say it on a specific case on a specific day?
A year to live, it's obvious they've been drinking for quite a long time.
No doubt about that at all. No doubt about that. I was just referring to the specific question you asked. It'd be very difficult to prove that on that particular occasion that the judge was not capable of doing his job.
Thank you, ma'am. Do you, Vic Stephens, accept the waffling and wavering by guard and whatnot, nothing we can really do, we don't want him to sit. Alan Williams showed much sounder common sense when Gardner was out of town. But do you accept the fact that the cabinet cannot now take the necessary action to correct the decision of the BC Judicial Council?
The government can do whatever it chooses to do if it wishes. I'm not sure specifically whether the cabinet itself has the legal authority to step in, but if it doesn't, it can soon give itself that authority.
Have to be by act of legislature.
Yes, it may have to be, but again, that's what the legislature is there for, isn't it? They don't have any problem in calling the legislature back into session if they want to settle a strike.
No.
The question is whether they consider this serious enough or not to do it. That's the question.
If you were premier of this province, would you leave this particular judge on leave of absence until you could pass a bill in the session?
Yes, if I was the premier of this province, I would do everything I could to make sure that Judge Benrod did not sit on the bench again until he had rehabilitated himself.
Webster.
And I must say that he may be perfectly capable of doing that, and I hope so, because I happen to know the man and I happen to like him very much.
Webster and Vic Stephens. Go ahead, please, to Vic Stephens.
Oh, yes, sir. Good morning. Good morning. You take some criticism on your show?
Please. That's why we're here.
Okay. I would say it's not so important you push around for this guy. You know, whatever he has done, if he has done a mistake, okay, and he resigned from his position, and if we are thinking it's a quite high position, so whatever it is, you know, if he wouldn't resign, everybody would say he have to resign, but so he have done it. Every coin have two sides, if you understand what I mean.
Well, I think you're quite right. Resignation was the proper thing for the judge to do, but not to resign and leave the public with the impression that he may be resigning on a false accusation. That's the question that has to be resolved.
Yeah, but we have a nice thing, you know. I just tell you what was happened with Richard Nixon.
Richard Nixon?
Well, what about Richard Nixon?
Yeah, what about?
He should have gone to jail.
Oh, but he is not going.
Well, no, I'm not going to measure the standard of behavior in our country against that. I've always considered that the standard of ethics and behavior in this country is very high, and I want to fight for it and protect it. We're not going to measure it against some other country.
Well, I feel
thank
to
you.
Go to prostitution or whatever it is, that's not a criminal offense or whatever it is, you know. And
quite.
That's not a problem to make a balloon from this, you know. I feel in this country there are much bigger problems or whatever it is to clear it out, you know. But not the things like this to just you know.
Thank you, sir. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack.
Morning.
Good morning, Mr. Stephens.
Good morning.
I'd like to ask a question and make two quick comments, if I may. One, to my understanding, our Parliament passes laws, right? They pass the laws for the land.
Yes.
But however, the judiciary amends these laws through the acts of precedent.
Well, they technically don't amend them. Sometimes that is the result.
Or alter them, or somehow along that
line?
Well,
the judiciary interprets it. Sometimes they may interpret it wrongly, but that's the
job. I'd say just an ordinary guy on the street here right now, we seem to be in a lot of trouble because, first of all, Vancouver's in lots of trouble with hookers and the rest. And whether just by accident or whatever, however you want to look at it, all of a sudden here's a chief justice and a judge, all immediately involved in hookers, and they have left Vancouver with a big problem. Now, I'll leave that one alone. So, I mean, that's just however it comes. Now,
you want to tackle that one?
Well, I'd just like to say that the problem that I've been directing my attention to here today is not the number of hookers that are operating in the city of Vancouver. That's an entirely different issue.
Maybe an entirely different issue to you as a lawyer and a politician, but let me tell you, the man in the street is now a laughing matter.
No,
which affects the status of the judiciary. It's a laughing matter. It is.
Well, I'm not denying that, but I'm simply
trying... And the man in the street says, oh, good, there's so many hookers down in Georgia Street because the judges are all chasing them. Now, you know, I'm putting it extravagantly, but this is the damnable... No, it's the damnable danger of this kind of thing.
Well, listen, you've got prostitution in every city in the world.
In this particular case, in this particular city, we've got the worst prostitution we've ever seen.
And perhaps one of the most blatant anywhere in the world. But that's got nothing to do with judges.
I know it's got nothing to do with judges, but the circumstances cause the system of the administration of justice to be held in disrepute because they coincide.
Well, a lot of things coincide.
And there are other things. That question that was put to, what's his name, Lalonde this morning, were the police out to get him? I know where that question came from. That question came from some people in Ottawa who were trying to find a justification to reject the police involvement in this thing, because, like it or lump it, the police were involved in this investigation, and they were involved in a drug investigation at the time. But somebody wants to get the heat off, so they feed some Eastern reporter who doesn't know what the devil's happening. Where are the police out to get? I mean, really, if I were one of the policemen in Vancouver working on these cases, I'd be almost ready to sue, wouldn't you? They were doing their duty in the normal course of events, and up comes the Chief Justice. Wham, they go in.
Well, that's the information that you have, Jack.
That's public information.
It may be accurate, it may not be. How do you know? How
because
will
the
we
Chief
know?
Justice said, because Lalonde said that yes, there had been an investigation. Yes, they had been looking for drugs, but no charges resulted, only the body house charge. Now, that came from Lalonde yesterday in the press conference I showed this morning. And I merely...
Yeah, but why should we be expected to accept Lalonde's statement on this?
Oh, you're right.
I'm not suggesting he's telling a lie.
No.
I'm suggesting we are not getting all of the facts.
You're right, and I am wrong.
No,
let me finish this with Vic. This is very important. What Vic is doing, Vic is cutting down my repertorial instincts properly to say that what I may have learned or what I may believe to be the truth is not necessarily the truth. The only way we can get the truth is by a properly sworn public inquiry.
Yeah, and there's nothing new about that. Our whole justice system has survived on that for hundreds of years.
I accept the rebuke, and thank you, sir. 1303, hold on, please. Vernon, go ahead, please.
Yes.
Is that the wrong one? The bottom one. Go ahead from Vernon, please.
Good morning. About Judge Farris.
Yes.
We heard on the news media that this young fellow that reported...
That's nothing to do with him. You're on the wrong topic, ma'am. No young fellow is involved in reporting anybody in that case. Oh, no. Let me explain to you. Ma'am, you've got everything all mixed up and your facts are totally wrong and I don't have time to explain it. That's one of the dangers. You've got to watch these telephone call references to people who confuse the two cases very closely. Where? Barrier, BC, go ahead, please.
Yes, I would like to say that I do agree with a public inquiry in order that the public might have the air cleared regarding the integrity of the judges, all of them. But what I would like to know is what can we, in the public or of the public, do to sort of force the issue?
Take political action, I suppose. Is that right, Vic?
Well, I think you and I are doing what we think should be done, and I think that anybody else can do the same thing to a greater or lesser extent. You have a member of parliament in your area, get a hold of him. Put some pressure on him. Tell him you want an answer. That's what he's there for.
Right.
That's really the only thing you can do. Drop a note to Lalonde or Gardy Gardam. I wouldn't bother with Gardam.
Then the government can do whatever it chooses to do anyway.
No, but if you're concerned with the way the system works, this is not a minor molehill that anybody's trying to make into a mountain, is it?
No. It's the heart of everything.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yes.
Tell me this. What is the warrant out for the arrest of Raymond Young?
The warrant is in connection with a body house at, I think it's the same address. Hold on a second while I check that. I just don't want to say something that I don't know about. I'll take a break and check that and be back in a couple of minutes. Hold on, please. Are you the guy that asked about Young?
Yes.
A summons has been issued. There's no warrant out for his arrest.
Oh, a summons. No warrant.
No, hold on, please.
Jack, 9 minutes in the segment.
There is no warrant out for the arrest of the gentleman you named, sir. There's a summons has been issued for an appearance at some date, maybe now, and it's in the short future, in connection with keeping a body house. Go ahead, please.
On the Farris affair, Jack.
Yes, ma'am.
One brief comment. My conclusion in this sordid matter is that the influence of one man's family name is greater. That influence is greater than the influence of the whole judicial system of this country.
Mr. Stephens?
That's a very good point. I don't think that anybody is so naive as to think that the Farris family doesn't have a great amount of influence in Ottawa. Always has had, still does have.
I appreciate that. I think you're doing a good job. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Mr. Webster. What appalled me most in the interrogation of Mr. Lalonde by reporters was his answer to the question, what will happen to the cases heard by Mr. Farris on which a decision hasn't been handed down? Now, Mr. Lalonde said that he will still hand down the decisions in these cases, and one is a sexual case, the Papa John case.
Well, ma'am, I'll give you my own opinion. I don't know if Mr. Stephens is willing to speak that. He doesn't. I have, as a reporter, checked the facts in that. And while Mr. Farris was on leave of absence, although the appeal was heard prior to this controversy publicly erupting, although we now know this went back as far as August 16, his decision was handed down and the signature appended while he was technically on leave of absence. And I say, as a layman on the air, and in contradiction of the Minister of Justice, who didn't want to touch it with a barge pole, that is wrong and that case will have to be re-argued.
Well, Jack, I think I'd have to know what the facts are, but there's other facts that you've got to consider in a situation like that, namely the person who is primarily before the court. That person and that person's lawyer, no doubt, would have some input into whether the judgment should be handed down or not.
Oh, I see what you're making.
Oh, yeah, it may very well be, and I don't know, because I don't know the facts. It may very well be that the lawyer representing the appellant said, look, we want this decision handed down. We don't want anything to interfere with it. There's been a lot of hard work and time gone into this thing, and we're perfectly satisfied.
Oh, prepared to accept it.
Perfectly satisfied with Judge Farris's opinion or decision. Now, I don't know.
We don't know. But on the other hand,
you got to consider that.
On the other hand, I, as a member of the public, find it quite distasteful that a judge who has been publicly accused and fled and takes a leave of absence with the minister, with the Lang's permission, then appends his signature to a current document. Because as we all know, justice must be seen to be done.
Well, it's his judgment. It's judgment that he presumably gave while he was still sitting on the bench. He heard the case. I'm not saying it's
not
right or wrong. I think that there's more to it.
More to it than that.
Just
perhaps we should reserve judgment on it.
Yeah, okay.
He heard the case.
No, that's enough on that, ma'am. Go ahead, please.
Yeah, there's one thing that really concerns me, and that is that the very light manner in which the Farris matter has been handled may give rise to some serious questions regarding the laws on prostitution. Pardon me. To my mind, a solicitor, male or female, are quite unfairly held totally responsible for prostitution. If it weren't for their customers, the profession couldn't survive. So in essence, those who pay for it perpetuate the trade. And when BC's highest law official consorts with a prostitute, or allegedly consorts with a prostitute, can't you see that that may give rise to a movement towards decriminalization of prostitution?
Well, I think that we've almost totally decriminalized prostitution through the recent court decisions. I think you make a valid point. Prostitution has been with us since the world began, and I suggest it's going to continue. In my opinion, it's a matter of exerting some more efficient control over it and certainly getting it off the streets.
I bet the woman makes a very good point. You, of course, are talking about the Deborah Hutt case,
yes.
Right.
which the Supreme Court of Canada's, to me, incomprehensible decision.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But the fact remains, too, that the Attorney General of British Columbia, Neil McDermott, his deputy, not so long ago, issued a specific direction to Regional Crown Council, pointing out that the Paris decision for the customer, which was knocked down here, has now got a new precedent in Ontario. And McDermott said, you can charge the customers of prostitutes, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's from the Attorney General of BC himself, which further complicates the matter. But we had agreed that the laws must be tightened up, not slackened, you know, to clear the streets of the rogues and vagabonds. Yeah.
Prostitution itself really has not been illegal for a long time, that not since I can remember in any event. It's not been illegal. It's the solicitation that has given rise to the charges and convictions.
And now the solicitation has to be so physical that nobody can be convicted.
Yes, that's right.
Ma'am, you raise a very valid point.
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning, Jack and Mr. Stephens.
Good morning.
I want to bring up a slightly different angle to this whole situation, and it's in regards to the Attorney General saying that they cannot do anything because it is the Judicial Council's jurisdiction. Well, this is ludicrous because it is the legislative assembly that gives the Judicial Council its powers. And therefore, it is poor legislation which should be corrected.
Benrod
case. I agree entirely. Sometimes legislation cannot be improved until we find its weakness. If we have found a weakness in that legislation, you're quite right. Let's change it. Let's strengthen it up.
It should be forthwith in the next sitting.
I agree.
Matter of fact, it must be forthwith in the next sitting.
What about the federal level? Now, does the Judicial Council there have the same limited powers as the provincial one?
I don't know.
I can tell you that. The Judicial Council's powers are to investigate on complaint the conduct of any judge. But if that judge at any time is liable to be an accused or a witness in a case, they will not touch it until that matter is disposed of. A judge can only be fired for cause by a joint address of the House of Commons or the Senate supported by two-thirds of the member. A judge's resignation can be accepted by order and council of the federal cabinet. The moment the judge resigns, as in the Farris case yesterday, the Judicial Council feels that it is no longer seized with any inquiry.
So
therefore, when he resigned, that took the Judicial Council off the hook. They were finished with it. And if there were to be any detailed investigation, in my view, Vic, I don't know if you agree or not, it would have to be done by the Attorney General of the province of British Columbia as a police matter, in a hypothetical case.
To me, Mr. Webster, then, the legislation federally is very poor because it is in itself making the Judicial Council, if it finds anything, I mean, limited, and lawyers draft this up. And so it makes me very, I'm not saying it was purposely drafted that way, but they should have known better to have...
No, let me just, I've just got time to say this. I think the way the Federal Judicial Council sits now, Vic, it's quite good. Because if a judge gets involved in something and he resigns, whammo, and the resignation is accepted, he's out. And that means if anything happens thereafter, he goes to that proceedings as a witness or whatever, as a citizen and not as a judge. And I think that's good. I don't think the Judicial Council should have to do the detailed investigation leading to appearances somewhere. See my point, Vic?
No, it's primarily a court that should hear the evidence. That's in.
Okay, got to go. Vic Stephens, we haven't even mentioned your normal realm of politics. Very briefly, do you feel as lonely as the previous Tory leader?
Well, I can say, Jack, that we have surged so strongly in the last 6 months in this province. I've got many candidates and potential candidates coming forward. We're feeling a very good, strong team. I'm excited about it. As a matter of fact, politicians like to predict. If you want a prediction, I say that we're going to have a minority government in British Columbia after the next election.
In other words, these Tories are going to help defeat social credit.
Well, I won't predict which of the three parties is going to hold the minority, but...